Hey everybody, David Burr with Neo7 CNC, and I wanted to do another laser video. Now, this isn't really a review or anything specific to the Atomstack A5 Pro, other than the fact that that's the only laser I have. I got a lot of questions about lasers in general, about the process of committing something to either an etch or a cut, what that looks like, how long that takes, what you can expect. And so what I want to do in this video is kind of follow up the first video and be like, okay, this is real world. If you walked into a store and you bought one of these machines, what can you expect? What's the process like? So in this video, I'm going to do that. And by using multiple cameras and doing some screen recording, I'm going to show you everything that I'm doing. And then we'll actually be able to see the results, see if they're good enough or not. Redo them if they're not, and kind of do a post checkup to see where we ended up. So this is going to be a lengthy video, and I'm going to put timestamps down below to the different sections so you can hop around if you want to. I do appreciate your time. Thanks for watching. Be sure you're a subscriber and have the notifications turned on, and I would really appreciate that, and I hope you enjoy the video. All right, hey everyone, it is David with Neo7 CNC, and I wanted to do a follow-up video on the Atomstack laser video that I did. That created a lot of interactions, and I've fully enjoyed that. I've been able to answer some of those questions online, but some of them I need to show you to answer the questions. So some of the things that were brought up in the comments were, what's the min and max cutting speed for the Atomstack? I didn't talk specifically about laser power and speed when I was doing the cuts. And if I can give an answer to that, it's because there's no true recipe for this is exactly what it's going to take to do this exact material. In my case, because I'm just using random materials that I purchased off eBay or Amazon that I had sitting around, things that I had stuck in a drawer somewhere. So it doesn't necessarily fit the recipe or the this is what you do here to get this there kind of scenario. So, and I believe I mentioned this in the video, so it takes a little bit of playing with to really understand your machine, your material. And so you have to play with the speeds, more specifically the speeds, and then the power. It really depends on what you're looking for. If you're trying to cut, then you're going to give it all the power you've got. If you're trying to do just a surface etch, then you might back the power off a little bit. And this is why I stressed testing the jobs before you actually commit them to the final material. You need to have an analog, a material that is preferably identical to what you're trying to produce, so that you can get an accurate understanding of how it's going to perform when you do your particular job to it, be it engraving or cutting. So we'll get more into that in a minute. Someone asked if it was an 8-bit or 32-bit controller for the laser. I don't know the answer to that. If I can find some information before I post the video, then it'll be somewhere on the screen. Someone asked what the thickest material that it could cut. I had cut wood coasters that were approximately 2.6, 2.7 millimeters. That's multiple passes to get through that layer. Other people had mentioned that you can use what's called an air assist, which actually helps evacuate the smoke out of the beam area so that the laser can do more work and ultimately go thicker. I think your mileage is going to vary with that. I don't have an air assist on this particular unit. Hopefully in the future when I test other units, I'll have one and we'll be able to speak more intelligently about that particular subject. But as of right now, 2.7 is what I've done max. That's all I've really tried. How long does it take to engrave? That was something that I didn't really get specific about when I did the first video either. And we're gonna address that today. Somebody wanted to see the machine in action. I had a little kind of picture in picture as I was doing one of the cuts. Once you watch it the first time, there's not a whole lot to watch. It's really like if you've ever watched an old dot matrix printer going back and forth, it's very similar to that depending on what you're cutting. If it's an image, it's going to do kind of a raster like that, or if it's line cutting or something, then it's more like vector controlled, so it will be following the lines of whatever it is you're trying to do. But I will have better shots of that. And then someone asked if it can do golden acrylic. I don't have any golden acrylic. I assume that if I had some that was the correct thickness, that it should be able to do it. Acrylic is one of the materials it's supposed to be able to handle. I don't have any to test, so I'll just leave that there. So what I want to do in this video specifically is, if you were just walking through a store one day and one of these items just happened to be on the shelf and you had either a personal need or a business idea need, or for some reason you just had to buy that machine, I want to show you what that experience would be. That's kind of what I did. I didn't film it, but I want to show you the process. I want to show you, okay, I found this thing online and I want to commit it to a piece of wood or some other material. I want to show you what that process looks like from start to finish. So that's my goal with this video, is to answer the questions that I've already mentioned, and hopefully organically through showing you the start to finish process, I'll answer some more questions that weren't asked. So I just brought out a bunch of things that I used in the first video, and in this one, this is again that 2.6, 2.7 millimeter plywood. This just happens to be called a wooden coaster on Amazon. And in this scenario, I was using 100% laser power. I was moving at 1200 millimeters per second, and this was done in 10 passes. One thing that I will warn you about is I had set up a jig. I was cutting out lots of these little earring shapes, just kind of playing around to see how many I could get out of one piece. And the quality on these coasters, this is going to vary depending on where you get them from, who the supplier is, all those kind of things. So it's not a guarantee. 10 passes was what it took for this one. Now, there seems to be an average. I did run into some when I was doing this other little, it was intended to be sort of like an art project, some sculpture kind of thing, but I was cutting out a bunch of rings, and these are all nested. You can see that this one didn't make it all the way through. There's a little flick there, and this is what you can expect when you run the same recipe, but your material acts differently. These didn't release. They're kind of hinged, and so if you can see on the back of that, they're not completely cut through. Most of them did okay, where they cut completely through, but not all of them. And I blame that, at least at this point, I blame that on variances in the material. So that's always going to be something that you have to mess with, specifically with wood, obviously acrylics, other materials, certainly anything that you're etching. You would also run into a similar issue where the etch might be lighter or not as deep in the material as you would like. But that also goes back to what I mentioned in the first video, as the wood grain actually comes through. In this particular case, if this was black walnut or some other kind of material that wasn't plywood, it might act a little bit differently. So that's what I mean about your mileage will vary. That could be said for the leather as well. Depends on the thickness. It could depend on the age. The color of it will play a part. One thing that was brought up in the comments that I wanted to touch on was, and I don't have one of them, but somebody wanted to engrave like jewelry or rings or knife blades, different things like that. This is not your guy for that kind of job. The jobs that I showed you was a specific stainless steel business card, and what the laser is doing is it is annealing the metal, which changes its color. It's not etching it, you can't feel it, it's actually just putting enough heat into the material to change the color. So understand that if you're trying to do gold or silver or other types of metals, I doubt it would do anything. The other item that I showed was this black aluminum business card, and the reason this was able to, let's quote air quotes, etch this, is that it's burning the paint off of it, and that's what gives you the contrast. So understand that this type of laser doesn't have that kind of power to punch into metallic objects. It's really, it's almost like a magic trick. It's either removing the paint or it's changing the color of the material. And so material choice is very important. If you wanted to actually embed or etch into the metal, you would need to look at something like a fiber laser, or in certain cases, CO2 lasers can do that with some spray additives to actually cause a bonding of material onto the metal, still not actually etching it. In most kind of prosumer, like trophy shop kind of environments. But a fiber laser, a lot like you see on eBay, Amazon, I've seen those where people are doing firearms, they're doing knives, they're doing parts as they produce them off a production line to serialize those parts. Fiber lasers are well suited for metallic marking. And in some kinds, you know, even digging in deeply, if you go over it again and again, as far as the number of passes. So I just wanted to touch on the materials for a second. And if you have any questions specifically about that, please leave those down below. All right, so you've got whatever laser out of the box. It's put together, it's ready to use. And now we need to actually do the computer side of the work so we can actually commit something to the machine so it can etch or cut or whatever we're trying to do. So as I mentioned in the first video, there were two software programs that I used to do the testing that I did originally. And that was Laser Gerbil and Lightburn. Now, Laser Gerbil is a free program to use. I used it to get some pretty successful images committed to engraving in some wood. And that was kind of as far as I went with it. It was not as intuitive as I would have liked, but it's free. So it's one of those things you kind of get what you pay for, so to speak. I then kind of ventured into Lightburn and very quickly justified the $40 that the license of it cost. There is a trial, but I just went ahead and paid for it and have not regretted it one bit. All the different things that I've done, it's made it so much easier, whether I was just doing some kind of artsy projects that I was working on, some mechanical art type stuff that I wanted to play with. Having the laser and being able to cut things, coming from a CNC background, you can definitely see a laser's place in a prototyping shop, let's say. You don't really have to worry so much about kerf, or it gives you the ability to do things way quicker than setting up a CNC job and changing bits and worrying about bit diameters and different things like that. It's good for certain things, it's not good for everything, and that's just like most tools. You wouldn't want to be doing this with a water jet machine, so every machine has their place. But I've enjoyed the different capability that a laser kind of brings to bear, especially for a hobby slash prototype shop environment that I'm in. So back to Lightburn. So I ended up buying it, like I said, and it gives you a lot more functionality inside the program. So instead of having to go out and find something to cut or etch, I can actually create it inside of Lightburn. And it makes doing that even easier because you can kind of grab corners and scale things. You can tweak some of the settings by hand, some of the stuff that's not readily easy to do inside a Laser Gerbil. So without bumping my gums anymore, we'll just get into Lightburn. And the test that we're going to do is I just grabbed a random image off the internet. It was a decent quality, about 900 by 1,000 on the pixels. And we're going to commit that to one of these 4x4 coasters that I used in the last video. It's a very inexpensive and easy thing to either cut or etch into. And so we'll use that as an example today. Before we get into that specifically, let's talk a little bit about Lightburn. This is not meant to be a full review or anything of Lightburn. I simply just figured out how to do what I wanted to do, and that's about the depth that I have inside the program. So take that for what it's worth. So very quickly, you'll recognize some of these things from other image programs, whether it's a Photoshop type of program or some other freeware version. There's a lot of things that you can do. You can draw shapes, you can add text, you can measure things, you can move things to the front, move things to the back if you're doing kind of a composite. But let's bring in, by importing, the image that we want to do, and that's this dragonfly, this gorgeous picture. Even in black and white, it's just amazing. I love nature, and it's just cool seeing an up-close picture of this critter. So it brought it in at whatever scale it wanted to bring it in. I didn't really specify it. And this might be conducive to the resolution that the first image or the image that I downloaded was, which is fine. The machine can do that. You see it fits in the workspace. However, we're trying to do 4 inches maximum in any dimension. So what I'll need to do here is, you'll see the width right here, and the lock is highlighted here, meaning these are ratio locked. So if I change one, it's automatically going to change the other. So 4 inches is roughly 100 millimeters. Let's give ourselves a little bit of a margin of error, and we'll change it to 90 millimeters. And you'll see it automatically change the height to just shy of 60 millimeters. And so now we have our image right there. To the left of the image height and width, we have the X and Y position. And this is where this work or this job is going to be positioned in the work envelope of the machine. You see that the scales across the top and down the side, it's 400 roughly by 400. And that's the usable work area of the Atomstack A5 Pro. Again, this is not a review of the Atomstack. This is just the only laser tool that I have to kind of talk more about the process of using one of these desktop laser engravers. So here in the XY position, I want to put this dead center, because I've done jobs in the past where I did a lot of jobs. I did one for my daughter where she was going to summer camp and we made a bunch of little circular medallions that had the name of the camp, what year, had her name on it, and they used these to trade with other campers, so they kind of build memories and meet people, and everybody kind of brings something different to trade. And so we made, you know, upwards of 75, almost 100 of those things, and that was, I think I could get five out of each square. I forgot what the diameter of the circle was, but I could, very closely nested, I could get five out of one of these squares. And so that was a job that I was running over and over and over again. So I ended up using this hunk of wood that is actually a piece of scrap from a 2x6 that I cut out to put a blast gate so that I could allow air to come in so the exhaust fan for the laser could take the dirty air out. And so this little puck was sitting around, so I'm like, well, I'll just put some registration marks on here, and that way I can put this on the machine, and once I get it dialed in, I've got these registration bosses, let's say, and I could constantly put the part in and have it in the same location. And so the reason that this 200 by 200 is important is that once this is set into where the machine thinks the dead center of that 200 by 200 is right here in the middle of this piece of wood, then I can just do the same thing over and over again. And I just had this sitting under the laser head and had some heavy weights around it to keep this from moving, which it wouldn't move, but I was afraid that when I was taking things off and putting them back on that I would bump it and move it. So I didn't actually have this attached per se. I just had it barricaded in with some weights. And so that's why I put emphasis on this, because you could have multiple jigs set up inside the work area of the machine, and you could go in and change your XY coordinates and land on those jigs if you had different jobs. I call them jigs, but you could also call them fixtures. And so it would just make your workflow a lot more, it would just make it quicker. And that way, let's say you had five different jobs that you ran a lot, and maybe even you had multiple machines, but you dedicated this one machine to those five jobs, then once you get them set up the first time, it's just cookie cutter after that, no matter what position or what fixture you're using, because you know where the home position for each one of those fixtures are. So enough about that. So I've got it dead center now. We've got our size correct. When you come into light burn, you're normally going to see this console screen. If I was connected to the laser right now and it was on, you would see some verbiage in that where the software kind of did a handshake with the laser and said, hey, I'm awake, you know, we're talking, we're communicating, stuff like that. We don't see that now because we're not plugged into the laser. But the other tab that I really go to is the cuts and layers tab. Now, in this case, we only have one layer. We're only doing one thing. This is an etch or an engraving. And so the main things that we want to look at right here are the speed, the power of the laser, how many passes we're going to do, and then the interval. Now the interval in CNC terms, and if you're not familiar with that, I'll explain, but in CNC terms, if you've got a bit that's a certain diameter, you have a, they call it a step over. And so if I do a cut, then I'm gonna step over a certain amount of space and do another cut. If you're trying to cut something completely, you know, cut something down to a lower height, then your step over matters, because you have to have some overlap to be able to get all the material out of the way. In the laser, it's not exactly the same, But the step over is still important, because I have found by personal experience that if you think you can crank that step over down, which means the lines are going to be closer together, it has some, it had some unexpected consequences. And that is that you're actually erasing any 3D detail that you may have cut in on that first pass. If you don't give enough space between the lines that the laser is making, then there's nothing left. You're basically just burning in a crevasse into the wood, and you're not going to get the detail that you're looking for. So that's something to consider. If you turn the power up too high and your lines are closer together, then you'll get an even worse result. So you kind of have to tread lightly. And the common theme with this whole video should be that this is an experiment. You have to learn the machine, you have to learn the material, and consistency in the material is going to be important, but you may not always be afforded to that. Every one of these 4x4 blanks of plywood is different. Some of them have lines of grain through them, some of them are different colors. And so that's going to be something that you're going to run into. Now, if you're using a more consistent wood or a material like craft paper or acrylic or something like that, then you could expect a little bit more consistent results. But this is more of an art than it is a science, and don't forget that. So this is the way that I cut this the first time. My original video on this got corrupt because the battery in the camera died, so I'm kind of redoing this. But I started at this 1800 millimeters per minute speed with an 80% max power one pass, and then the layer, the interval was 0.1 millimeter, which, if you'll remember, this is almost 60 millimeters tall, so that's going to be 600 lines. So the laser is going to be going back and forth 600 times to do this entire image. That's going to take some time. And yes, I'm doing a little bit of foreshadowing here. So this is basically ready to go, except for one thing. We want to etch this. Down here, it says cut selected graphics, and that is turned on. We want to turn that off because we're not trying to cut this. We're trying to make an image. And so you could basically save this job and you're ready to go, or not save it. But if we were connected to the laser right now, the next thing that I would do is I would click this frame button, and that would make the laser go around and say, okay, this is where I'm about to do the work. And you want to just kind of eyeball that and verify it. Some machines, not this one, but some machines will actually show you a standard laser pointer LED, which will let you really line up the material very well so you can get it centered or closer to the edge if you're trying to do that. This one, I just kind of watch where the lens is and just, you know, kind of mentally know where that's going to land so that I know the material's in the business area that it needs to be in. Once I've done that and I've verified the placement, then I would just click start, and the laser is going to do what it's going to do. Again, ventilation is extremely important. Make sure you're doing this in a well-ventilated area. If you'll go back and look at the first video, I created a whole apparatus to handle the fumes, and it does a good job. So I'm glad I did. I learned that the hard way by not getting the fumes out, and it's not a pleasant experience for my respiratory system. So. So that would be done. So you'll see later in the video that we're going to do this a couple of times, and the results will be interesting, speaking back to the speeds and the laser power. So the next thing that I want to do, so that's an example of an etch. Let's do a stencil. That's something that I've done for some different storage totes and different things around the house already, and I've had really good results. The way that I did it for this video was different from the way that I did it for myself, and I learned a few things along the way. So I deleted the image. So all we need to do here is go and grab this text tool, and I know there's a couple of stencil fonts in this library, and I'm gonna go for the very basic one that says stencil. And we're gonna grab that, and I'm just going to type Neo 7 CNC. Now, it just started placing that wherever I stuck the cursor on the work area. I know that I want this to be, let's say, roughly 5 inches long. Right now, let me click the select tool. So now that we have it like this, we can move it around. I can grab the corners and scale it. an interesting thing. If I go below the origin, I can flip it upside down. You can also rotate it if you desire. But I know that I want this to be 5 inches, so let's just call that 125 millimeters. And again, it's gonna, sorry about the mic, it's gonna adjust the height to keep the scale consistent. And we'll go over here and we'll change our position back to 200 by 200, so we're in the middle. And that looks pretty good. So over here, it defaulted to some different settings. The first thing I want to do is make sure that cut selected graphics is on, because it's the laser is just going to follow the line. It's not going to try to color these letters in or anything like that. It's just going to follow the line and do the cut. So the defaults that came up were 1200 millimeters per minute, 100% power, which makes perfect sense. If I'm trying to cut something, why wouldn't you want to do 100% power? The one that I don't fully understand, that hopefully by the time I actually put this in post, I can put something on the screen somewhere. What does power min do? I don't have an answer for that right this second, but maybe I will, maybe I won't by the time I post the video. But I don't mess with that. I just leave it as is, and I've had good results. So maybe ignorance is bliss on that one. So again, from here, all I would do is do frame, make sure I'm on the material, and then I would hit start. And the first time I did these stencils for myself, I was like, okay, it's kind of thick paper, maybe I should do two passes. And I did that, and it did work, but as I was cutting out probably, let's say 20 stencils, when it would go around the second pass, sometimes the paper would curl. The little piece that I'd cut free would curl and it would stick up. And as the laser was coming back across to cut one of the other sections, it would bump the material and knock it cockeyed. And so then on the second pass, it would just start cutting in a new spot instead of going over the original line that it had cut, because now the material had shifted. And so in doing this test, I just left it at these settings for this particular paper. It's better than typing paper, but it's not like poster board or anything like that. And what I found out was it cut it just enough to where when I picked it up, you could still see the stencil, but the center pieces, the waste was still stuck to the paper, and I could just flick it like this and knock most of those pieces loose and then pull the rest of them free. And it was still clean enough that it didn't tear any of the paper. I was basically like a hanging chad, so to speak, of material, and we just kind of had to pop them loose. And it made a beautiful stencil. So that was just something I learned along the way, but that goes to show that what you think you might need to do, maybe you do, maybe you don't, you just take some playing. And every material is gonna be a little bit different. And I would expect that between lasers and different machines, different manufacturers, it's gonna be a little bit of a dance. So at this point, we'd be ready to go ahead and cut it. So in the next shots, we'll see what these look like. Okay, so the audio is going to be different because I'm not using my lav mic. But again, full disclosure, this is the current state of affairs. I believe this is an old window weight. That's what I was using to kind of hold that puck in the center, as well as some chunks of copper. But the job that I had on previously, the stencil job, was a little bit of a lower job for the laser. So I'm going to have to raise it up. So I wanted you to see the process again. That's too close as it is hitting everything. Sorry, that's the water running upstairs. So let's see, on the gradient scale on top of here, there's 200, and then, which is gonna be, actually it's gonna be kind of the bottom. So let's see, let me get a piece of wood. This is how it comes from Amazon, so you can kind of see. I ordered another pack because these are fun to kind of play with when I come up with different ideas, so I like having some on hand. All right, so we'll just pick one random. which is good because it shows us, look at the difference in the color. This is more of a yellow natural fiber wood. This is very white. So this is going to act, these two materials, just kind of to my other point, if you can see that color difference, it may be hard on the camera, but these are going to act different because we're dealing with light here. So, okay, so that's actually snug, which is not the way it's supposed to be. So if you remember, again, I keep referencing the first video, and I'll have a link above for that, but this little piece of plastic is actually my focusing card, let's call it. And so this is roughly 2 millimeters thick. And so what I do, I just loosened up these two screws on this particular unit. Again, this is the Atomstack A5 Pro. And it's as simple as sitting the laser down on that piece of plastic on top of the material that you're wanting to cut or etch. And so that is basically creating the spacer, which focuses the beam. So this is a fixed focus laser. So the material has to be at a specific distance from the lens for you to get the best result. So once we lock those two screws down, we take our plastic piece out, and now we have, and now it's in the right spot. Now, since I've got those little registration pins on here, there is a possibility that the laser is going to bump into those as I kind of feel out where this needs to sit. So I'm not going to have my weights sitting around here. So in the event that it does kind of bump, I want it to be able to move. And what I might actually do is, you know, what I think I'll do is I'm going to eyeball this first. So we'll turn the laser on. We'll get the laptop hooked up to it. I'll get the dragonfly image pulled up, which I think it still is. And I'll have it go and do that perimeter run to kind of show us where it's going to do the work. And then I'll put the fixture underneath it, and that way there, I have a lesser chance of hitting it. So let me get the laptop moved over, and we'll turn the exhaust fan on, which I conveniently have on a remote. All right. And I'm timing this too. This is some card stock. It's kind of thick craft paper, and I just sliced it off of an 8.5 by 11 sheet, and I'm just putting a little twist into it to take the warp out of it to make it flat. And let's do the frame. see where we stand. Okay. I have to select it to make sure it knows what I'm working on. And that looks pretty good. Let me cut the fan on. And we're going to set a timer. This is real time. All right, so that was just under a minute. Let me zoom out a bit. All right, so here's the piece. And we can just flick these pieces loose, which is kind of good. The problem that I had when I did the other stencils that I did for myself is that the pieces would actually come up while the laser was going over them, because I did two passes, and a couple of times these little shards, because I did two passes, they cut them completely free, and they would actually get up into and touch the bottom of the laser, and it would shift the material, and it would end up ruining it, because it was doing two passes. It would like ghost a second pass, but this turned out beautifully. No tear out on the backside, and it's just as sharp as you could ask for. And that was right at 53 seconds. All right, so I hope I've answered a lot of your questions. I hope I've answered questions that you didn't know you had. Undoubtedly, I've probably created some more questions. And if I have, leave those down below in the comments, and we will look at those in the next video. But I think the test turned out okay. I wish there was a little bit more definitive aha with this particular test. And it could be that I have exceeded the detail limitation of either material or possibly the laser. That might take some further investigation. I believe that this is legible from a readability standpoint. I'm going to kind of test my family and see if they can tell me what this is. This one, in a photo world, that would be overexposed or not enough lighting. It just looks lost because of the overburn. And so backing off, increasing the speed and backing off the power did us a lot of favors on this one. So the successful one, I would call it, was 2,700 millimeters a minute, 75% power, single pass. The one where we got too much overburn was 800 millimeters a minute, 100% power, single pass. So, you know, the material is going to play a factor on that. I haven't tried to do something like that in paper. Maybe that would be the next try. And I'll put the time that it took to do this. I'll have to go back and actually look at the camera, because I lost track of time and wasn't down here when it finished, so I couldn't stop the phone counter in time. But I'll put the relative times for each one somewhere. The second test we did was the stencil, and I think the stencil turned out great. I was thinking that it was going to need two passes, because that's what I had done in the past. But I did a single pass with this. The recipe was 1,200 millimeters a minute, 100% max, 20% min. I still don't know what that is. My fault. I need to look that up and see what the 20% min means. And the machine kind of gave me that as a default, so I just went with it. And then this was a single pass. Now you'll see from the video where the pieces were still hanging, like Hanging Chad, if you know what I'm, if you're familiar with that story. I'm going way back there. I was able to kind of flick the pieces and knock them loose and pull them loose, and it had no tears on the back from the pieces that were hanging. So I would call that a success, to where it really perfed the material and kept it in place, because as I had mentioned before, when I did some stencils earlier, I did two passes, and I can't remember what I'm sure the power was 100%, but I can't remember what the speed was, but I did two passes, and sometimes those pieces would pop up and they would get hung, and as the laser was moving around quickly, it would knock the piece cockeyed, and it would start cutting in a new area on the second pass, and that didn't work out. So this actually was a better result. So I'm pleased with that. So again, if you've got more questions, leave them down below. Hopefully I'll have other lasers to play with and to compare in the future, and we will certainly do a relative comparison, you know, with the same kind of cut jobs, and see what kind of results we get with different machines. But be sure to subscribe if you're not already subscribed, and make sure your notifications are turned on. And I really appreciate you taking the time to watch the video, and we'll talk to you next time.